It'll be Acts chapter 17, starting at verse 1.
When they had passed through Amphipolis and Apollonia, they came to Thessalonica, where there was a Jewish synagogue. As is his custom was, Paul went into the synagogue, and on three Sabbath days he reasoned with them from the Scriptures, explaining and proving that the Christ had to suffer and rise from the dead. "This Jesus I am proclaiming to you is the Christ," he said. Some of the Jews were persuaded and joined Paul and Silas, as did a large number of God-fearing Greeks, and not a few prominent women. But the Jews were jealous, so they rounded up some bad characters from the marketplace, formed a mob, and started a riot in the city. They rushed to Jason's house in search of Paul and Silas in order to bring them out to the crowd. But when they did not find them, they dragged Jason and some other brothers before the city officials, shouting, "These men who have caused trouble all over the world have now come here, and Jason has welcomed them into his house. They are all defying Caesar's decree, saying that there is another king, one called Jesus." When they heard this, the crowd and the city officials were thrown into turmoil. Then they made Jason and the others post bond and let them go. As soon as it was night, the brothers sent Paul and Silas away to Berea. On arriving there, they went to the Jewish synagogue. Now the Bereans were of more noble character than the Thessalonians, for they received the message with great eagerness and examined the Scriptures every day to see if what Paul said was true. Many of the Jews believed, as did also a number of prominent Greek women and many Greek men. When the Jews in Thessalonica learned that Paul was preaching the word of God at Berea, they went there too, agitating the crowds and stirring them up. The brothers immediately sent Paul to the coast, but Silas and Timothy stayed at Berea. The men who escorted Paul brought him to Athens and then left with instructions for Silas and Timothy to join him as soon as possible. While Paul was waiting for them in Athens, he was greatly distressed to see that the city was full of idols. So he reasoned in the synagogue with the Jews and the God-fearing Greeks, as well as in the marketplace day by day with those who happened to be there. A group of Epicurean and Stoic philosophers began to dispute with him. Some of them asked, "What is this babbler trying to say?" Others remarked, "He seems to be advocating foreign gods." They said this because Paul was preaching the good news about Jesus and the resurrection. Then they took him and brought him to a meeting of the Areopagus, where they said to him, "May we know what this new teaching is that you are presenting? You are bringing some strange ideas to our ears, and we want to know what they mean." All the Athenians and the foreigners who lived there spent their time doing nothing but talking about and listening to the latest ideas. Paul then stood up in the meeting of the Areopagus and said, "Men of Athens, I see that in every way you are very religious. For as I walked around and looked carefully at your objects of worship, I even found an altar with this inscription, 'To an unknown God.' Now what you worship as something unknown, I am going to proclaim to you. The God who made the world and everything in it is the Lord of heaven and earth, and does not live in temples built by hands. And he is not served by human hands as if he needed anything, because he himself gives all men life and breath and everything else. From one man he made every nation of men, that they should inhabit the whole earth, and he determined the time set for them and the exact places where they should live. God did this so that men would seek him and perhaps reach out for him and find him, though he is not far from each one of us. For in him we live and move and have our being. As some of your own poets have said, we are his offspring. Therefore, since we are God's offspring, we should not think that the divine being is like gold or silver or stone, an image made by man's design and skill. In the past, God overlooked such ignorance, but now he commands all people everywhere to repent. For he has set a day when he will judge the world with justice by the man he has appointed. He has given proof of this to all men by raising him from the dead." When they heard about the resurrection of the dead, some of them sneered, but others said, "We want to hear you again on this subject." At that, Paul left the council. A few men became followers of Paul and believed. Among them was Dionysius, a member of the Areopagus, also a woman named Damaris, and a number of others. As I was trying to grasp some concepts of what was going on in chapter 17, first I think it's important to note that Paul's continuing his second missionary journey. And we started off wanting to go see all the churches that he had set up, and he continued on that journey. And we learned in chapter 16 he was in Philippi, and then he moved on. Now we start off in Thessalonica and Berea and on to Athens. And along the way, what did he do? He did what he was commanded to do, which was to preach the gospel. That's what he was set apart for. And it's kind of interesting if you think about it. In Thessalonica, he faced opposition. In Berea, the people were more, as it says in the scriptures, were more noble character. But what happened there even then? As soon as the Jews from Thessalonica found out, they went down to Berea, and they started agitating the crowds, and once again, he faced opposition. In Athens, the same pattern happened. In each case, Paul reasoned in the synagogues, explained who Christ was, and there was opposition. And I started thinking about that, and I started thinking about how that is that for each and every one of us. Because if we are doing what God wants us to do, if we are following God's will, the Bible tells us that we will face opposition, because that's because we are doing what is right. And it's interesting because a few years ago, shortly after we started coming to church, I heard Pastor Paul preach that there is no safer place to be than in the center of God's will. And I was thinking about that. And in chapter 16, we learn that Paul wanted to go in one place, but he was told by the man of Macedonia, which was in a vision, and I believe was the Holy Spirit, was telling him, don't go there, go to this location. And that's what he did. He went to Macedonia. He followed God's leading. And he faced opposition, but he was protected. The brothers whisked him away, sent him on. And it doesn't tell in Scripture that any real harm came to him. And it was interesting, last night I was walking with Carl Thummel, and we were talking, and Carl says, you know, I don't know if you've heard this, Vince, or not, but, you know, there's really no safer place to be than the center of God's will. And I was smiling because it's so cool how God works, because Paul had said that, and it's really stuck with me. And then I was thinking about using that as one of my acts, and Carl repeated it. And I thought, wow, this is really obviously God speaking to me, saying that there is no safer place than to be in the center of God's will. But we know that doesn't necessarily mean there won't be problems. And my X fact for all of us to think about, and something for us to ponder, is that while there is really no safer place to be in God's will or than to be in the center of God's will, it doesn't mean that our activities won't be hard. And it doesn't mean we won't face trouble. And a scripture popped in my head, and I'm going to conclude with this. It's from the book of John. Very familiar. From chapter 16, verse 33. Jesus is speaking, I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In this world you will have trouble, but take heart, I have overcome the world.
Thank you. I appreciate that. I'm going to briefly pray, and then we're going to go into some teaching, some preaching from this chapter. Our Lord God, we pray that you would give the kind of peace in this room and a kind of a hush that allows us to be able to hear what you want to have communicated directly from this text and through the preaching and through your Holy Spirit ministering into the hearts of the people here. We thank you that you've given us these words, and there is something that you want us to know from this, and we pray that it would be coming through clearly now in Jesus' name. We pray. Amen. Our sermon series is Evangelism, the Holy Spirit, and the Early Church. The Apostle Paul is traveling with a missionary team that's being assembled There, of course, there's Paul. There's also a man named Silas who is his partner in this. And as they've gone along, they've added a doctor named Luke and a young man named Timothy. We've heard all about this in previous chapters. The task of evangelism in new places, places that has never been reached before, this is what Paul's task is in this journey. Evangelism was central to the life of the early church. It remains central to the church today. Today we're going to hear about Paul's evangelism efforts in three cities, Thessalonica and Berea and Athens. And then, as I said a few minutes ago, we're going to take some time to hear about your evangelism activities, people that you have recently shared Christ with. We start by hearing about Paul's travels in Macedonia. It says in verse 1, they passed through Amphipolis and Apollonia and so forth. And you say, where are all these places? What's going on? It's pretty simple. You remember that last week, the Apostle Paul, as we were studying last week, he was moving around in what is present-day Greece, and the Holy Spirit said, don't go here, and don't go here. And then God gave him a vision of a man from a place called Macedonia, which is just to the north of present-day Greece. And this man from Macedonia said in the vision, come over to Macedonia and help us. Clearly, this is where God wanted Paul to be. I want to tell you very clearly, listen now, it is right to arrange our lives to be where God wants us to be, doing what God wants us to do. The rest of the world might ask, what do I want to do? But God's man asks, what does God want me to do? And Paul was careful to make sure that he was where God wanted him to be. So Paul and Silas and Timothy and Luke went to Philippi. Where, and this is the first stop in Macedonia, they went to Philippi, and there were wonderful things that happened. One of them was that a jailer there said, what must I do to be saved? And he was one who reached out to the Lord and was saved. He and his whole household, we heard about that last week. There were also very difficult things that happened. That's why Paul was there in jail and met the jailer. There were troubles there too. And eventually Paul left Philippi, and he continued westward along what is called the Ignatian Way. It's a road that went through there, and it went from one city to another. And these are some of the cities here in verse 1 that are on that. And eventually he came to a place called Thessalonica. Let's take a look at a map here of Macedonia. He had come from Troas to Philippi and then around here to Thessalonica. He is traveling to Thessalonica, which is still in Macedonia, moving about, hitting key cities in Macedonia. Thessalonica was a fairly large city, at least for that time period it was. There were more than 200,000 people there. That is about twice the size of Ann Arbor. All right? Good-sized city. There were enough Jews there to comprise a synagogue, and on three successive Sabbath days, that is three Saturdays in a row, Paul went to the synagogue and met with the Jewish people there. He, as it says in verses 2 and 3, reasoned with them from the scriptures. He explained and proved that the Christ had to suffer and rise from the dead. He said, you have the Old Testament. You know from that that the Messiah needed to suffer and rise from the dead. That's what you can see in the scripture. And the one who did that was Jesus. And he, three Sabbaths in a row, demonstrated that to them. He said the following things. This Jesus I am proclaiming to you is the Christ. I keep telling you about Jesus, and he is not just anyone, even someone admirable. He is the Messiah that you've been waiting for. This is it. This was Jesus. Some Jews, it tells us in verse 4, were persuaded. They were convinced that Jesus was the Messiah. They wanted to learn more from Paul and Silas. There are others too, not just Jews. It says in verse 4, a large number of God-fearing Greeks, that is, Gentiles who were attending the synagogue, a large number of them were saved. More than a few prominent women followed after this. So we have another church established, a new church in Thessalonica. But as so often happens, this provokes a backlash from Satan. I want you to understand, there is a spiritual battle that goes on. As much as it seems like there are people who are doing things that are making trouble, it is Satan who is behind all of this. Satan does not want a new church to be established in Thessalonica, and so trouble emerges. And we hear, secondly, about a riot in Thessalonica, starting here at verse 5. But the Jews were jealous, it says. They were convinced that, let's try this again, the Jews were jealous. Paul was more influential than they wanted to be, and their concern wasn't with the truth. Their concern was anything they could do to sort of shut down Paul's influence. So it tells us what they did, verse 5. The language is interesting. They routed up some bad characters from the marketplace. I guess they went into where people hung around and they said, here are some people who like to create trouble. Let's get them to help us with this. They formed a mob and they started a riot in the city. Paul was being hosted in the home of a man named Jason. That's where he was staying as a home base for his ministry efforts. The mob rushed to Jason's house in verse 5 to capture Paul and Silas. They wanted to give Paul and Silas over to the fury of that mob, but, verse 6, they didn't find them there. Bang, 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 crash into Jason's house. Where's Paul and Silas? They're not here. And so, since they're not here, what could they do? Well, they seized Jason. Jason was simply Paul's host. They grabbed him. They also grabbed some other Christians who happened to be there with Jason at the time. And they dragged them before the city officials. They shouted their accusations against the Christians, especially against Paul and Silas, who they felt needed to be tried somehow. So they thought, well, they'll do this in absentia. They'll shout things about Paul and Silas, and they'll say, we got to get rid of this guy, even if Paul wasn't there. What did they shout? Let's take a look at the text. Still here in chapter 17. They shouted in verse 6, these men who have caused trouble all over the world have now come here, and Jason has welcomed them into his house. They are all defying Caesar's decrees, saying there's another king, one called Jesus. These guys are troublemakers. They're creating trouble all over the world. They've come here. And, of course, if they had been standing in front of a Jewish body, they would have said, in addition, these men are blasphemers. They are saying something about this guy Jesus being divine, and that's what we should get him on. Well, they weren't going to get any sympathy about that from a Jew or from a Gentile audience, from a Roman audience, and so they tried something different. They said, these men are traitors. They're saying we should follow somebody other than Caesar. That's what is really wrong with them. So that's what they tried. Now, I'm going to give you this same text in a different translation. It's one that comes a little closer to what the wording was that they said. These men who have turned the world upside down have come here also. When it says they've created trouble all over the world, what they were literally being accused of was turning the world upside down. In some ways, were they turning the world upside down? Yes, and probably not in the way they were being accused of. But they were bringing the message of Jesus Christ, which changes people's lives, and it was turning the world upside down. You see, when you just follow your own desires, when you follow the things of this world and what the rest of the world does, it all goes along in a certain way. But when Jesus becomes king of your life, it will turn your life upside down. And when Jesus becomes the king of a community and a city, it will turn that city upside down. And when Jesus becomes king of a nation, it will turn that nation upside down. Do you all understand this? And so they're being accused of turning the world upside down. It says Jason has received them. They're all acting against the decrees of Caesar, saying there is another king called Jesus. Now, I need to comment on this. Everyone listen. Christians are the best citizens that a nation could ever have. Christians will do things that are kind to their neighbors in every way they know how, to obeying the laws of the land, and being ones, if there were Christians scattered throughout a community, there would be far fewer needs for police and other protections. However, I will tell you this, and this is something that bothers some rulers. Even in spite of the fact that Christians will say, we will be good citizens in this land, they also will say, if there is a command that goes against that of Jesus, I must obey a higher king, and that king is Jesus. They're being accused of saying that there is a king, Jesus, who they will follow, and the truth is, that is right. They will follow Jesus even above Caesar if Caesar is against God. Did everyone understand this? This is what they're being accused of in this text. When they heard this, the crowd and the city officials, verse 8, were thrown into turmoil. they made Jason and the others post bond and let them go. What does this mean? They said, we don't have Paul and Silas right here in front of us. We'd love to do something terrible to them, but they were in a different location somewhere, you know, meeting with someone at a different home. They didn't know where to look. And so they said, we're going to do something about this. And so they'd already grabbed a hold of Jason, his host, and they said, all right, it's like this. There's rioting throughout the city, and the rioting is obviously the fault of these Christians. And you're hosting the Christians. And so all of the expenses of whatever happens with this rioting, Jason, will be your fault. And what we're going to do is we're going to confiscate some of your property, some of your money, maybe your home, whatever. We're going to confiscate this, and we're going to hold on to it. And if there's further rioting, we're going to keep it all. If there's no further rioting in the future, then we'll let you have your money back again. This was their way of assuring that things would stay peaceful. Now, did Jason start the rioting? No. Did the Christians start the rioting? No. But what they're really saying is, if Paul hangs around, then we're going to have another riot. And Jason, you're going to lose everything you have. You understand? That's what they're explaining to Jason. And so, as a result of that, we're going to find out that that night, when it was under the cover of darkness, they are going to smuggle Paul out of town and let things die down just a little bit. But we've already learned something important, an Acts fact that we'll put up here on the screen. Even the enemies of Christ understood that Christians served Jesus as king. In the accusation of the enemies, there was a lot of truth in it. Christians hold Jesus to be the highest authority in their lives. That made them angry, but it was true. Christians, Jesus should serve as the highest authority. He ought to be king. Even the enemies of Jesus know this. Even the enemies of Christ understood that Jesus served, that the Christians served Jesus as king, and Jesus is a king who turns the world upside down. We've learned this already as we've moved through our teaching about Thessalonica, but that brings us next to some Bible study in Berea. As soon as it was night, verse 10, the brothers sent Paul and Silas away to Berea. On arriving there, they went to the Jewish synagogue. We'll look at the map again just for a moment. We've seen where Thessalonica is here. The next town in Macedonia, still in Macedonia, is here in Berea. So they've been making a little loop from Philippi to Thessalonica to Berea, covering the major cities in Macedonia. They arrived in Berea, and on arriving there, they went to the Jewish synagogue. Now, the Bereans, it says, the people of Berea, verse 11, were of more noble character than the Thessalonians, further than the Thessalonians, for they received the message with great eagerness and examined the scriptures every day to see if what Paul said was true. Here we have a noble character, it says. The Bereans were of more noble character for two reasons. They received the message with great eagerness. They examined the scriptures every day to see if what Paul said was true. Let's understand this. Paul comes, and remember, in the previous town, for three successive Sabbaths, he'd gone into the synagogue and he explained all of this, and the main outcome was rioting and a lot of upset, although there were people who were saved. In this case, it didn't turn into riots. Paul would say, here's what the Bible says about this, and the people would study the Bible. They would say, let's take home our scriptures, or let's look more closely at this, and let's see if what Paul says is actually true. And they look deeply into this. They would use the Bible as the basis for their decisions about doctrine and faith. And this is, of course, correct, but it is, in all times and places, fairly unusual. All over the empire, whenever Paul bumped into Jews there, frequently those Jews would base their response to him or their response to Jesus on their own traditions. Do you remember this? They would always say, you're overthrowing our traditions. This isn't the way we do things, and they would be angry about it. It wasn't based on scripture, but based on other things they were making their decisions. This proceeds even into the centuries that followed that. There are and continue to be some church groups that base their practices on traditions. Even when it runs counter to Scripture, even when it's shown that it's counter to Scripture, you sit down with someone and say, this is what the Bible says, and they say, yes, yes, that may be so, but we've always done it this way. The Bible says our way of handling things and coming to decisions about what is truth and how we're going to practice things that should be based on what does the Bible say. Now I'll speak about individuals for a moment. Most people make spiritual decisions based on their own experiences and preferences. If you talk to them about what the Bible says, they say, yeah, but I prefer to think of it this way. I've always thought of it this way. The way that I think of it is this other thing instead. As if to say, the way I think of it is more important than the way that God sees it. This is a grave mistake. Instead, if we look at God's word and it says this, and if we look at our lives and it's different, we want to line up our lives with God's word. I'm going to say something very clear for a moment here. One of the main reasons people base their decisions on their experiences and preferences is so that they will not find their beliefs to get in the way of their sin. There is some area of sin in their life, and they will even begin to change what they believe to be further and further from the Bible so that they can accommodate that area of sin. This is fairly normal. The Bereans weren't those kind of people. They didn't say, it's all about our traditions, it's all about our preferences, it's all about condoning our sin. They said, what does the Bible say? That's what the Bereans did. And God says, this isn't my word, God says, that makes a noble character. It's a noble thing to have this desire. The Bereans said, let's line up our lives with the teachings of God's word. We'll put an Acts fact on the screen. God says that those who strive to have their lives and beliefs conform to Scripture are of noble character. Every church that belongs to Jesus Christ must be sure its doctrine and preaching are properly rooted in Scripture. Let me give you a few examples of this. Our church has a statement of faith, and it says these are the things that we believe. In that statement of faith, after virtually every sentence, there's in parenthesis some scripture references that says, this is where we derive these things from. These are rooted in the Word of God. It's appropriate to say, what does the Bible say, and that will influence our beliefs, rather than, what do we believe, what have we always thought of as being the truth, just because of our experience, that's what we'll stick with. I will say something else about all this. I have encouraged the families of our church that when they go home, and on Monday and Tuesday and Wednesday and Thursday and Friday and Saturday, it's not only appropriate, but it is noble and right to say, we are going to spend some time each day as a family reading in the Word of God. We are now going to be lining up our family with what the Bible itself says. You might say, well, I do that personally and privately on my own. I praise God for that. I think that's wonderful. There is something about reading the Word of God aloud in your household, even with the children present or anyone else who's there, and I'm going to expand the anyone else who's there to even the guests who are there. Don't set this aside if you've got company. When company comes to my house, they know that they've come to the home of Christians, and we finish dinner and we say, well, we're going to be reading from God's Word, and they hear it. And it doesn't do them any harm. All right? We hear the Word of God. We read it through. We discuss. What did we just see there? We try to line our lives up with what the Scriptures are teaching us. God says this is a noble thing for those who are in any place, whether it's Berea or in your home. This is the right thing to be doing. What happened as a result? Well, we see in verse 12 that many of the Jews believe. Many of the Jews, verse 12, believed, as did also a number of prominent Greek women and many Greek men. So there was a revival. When people start reading the Word of God, it begins to change their lives, and people began to get closer and closer to the Lord. Many of them believed, but as Mr. Hackle pointed out, there was opposition that arrived, and it didn't really come from the Berean people themselves, at least not initially. It happened this way, verse 13. When the Jews in Thessalonica learned that Paul was preaching the Word of God at Berea, they went there too. They said, we thought we got rid of this guy, and we did sort of, but he went to the next town, and he's, I'm sure, needing to be run out of that town too. And so some of them went there and brought the riot with them. He went there, agitating the crowds and stirring them up. The brothers immediately sent Paul to the coast, but Silas and Timothy stayed at Berea. The men who escorted Paul brought him to Athens and then left with instructions for Silas and Timothy to join him as soon as possible. Let's hear this. The Bible tells us that because there were fresh riots, Paul was slipped on out of town again. This time, they left some of the less high-profile guys, Silas and Timothy, back in Berea to help to finish establishing the church. They left them back, but Paul went to the coast, and either by the coastal road walking on down to Athens, or perhaps by way of ship, he got to Athens, and he is going to be there alone for a little bit. He left word that the rest of his missionary team should catch up with him as soon as they could. As soon as it's practical, as soon as they finished up their work, come join me. But Paul is going to be alone in Athens. And that brings us to our fourth point here, where we hear something about idols throughout Athens. What does Paul do while he's waiting in Athens? It would be typical. Listen, the average person would say, well, I'm here, but the rest of my missionary team isn't here. I think I'm going to rest up a little bit while I wait for them, and when they all arrive, then we'll get busy. I think what I'll do is, just sort of see the sights and wait for a little while. That wasn't Paul's manner. You see, if God has put him any place, even for a few days, or for a few weeks, or for a few months, he's going to try to do something there that is useful to the kingdom of God. I'm going to just apply this for a moment. I've known of many folks who've said, well, I went somewhere and had a summer job, and then I came back, and I'll say, well, while you were there, did you meet up with any Christians there? Well, I didn't really know anybody. Oh, I see. Did you share Christ with anyone? Well, I was kind of busy. I didn't really meet anyone. I just did. Oh, I see. The attitude was, I'm in a new place for the summer. I'm off. I'm off duty. I mean, I have my get-out-of-jail-free card. I don't have to serve the Lord and do anything there because I'm in a new time and a new place. God put you there, apparently, and he has a purpose for you. And the purpose was missed. You had 3 months to do something there. How long is the Apostle Paul in most of these cities? It doesn't look very long. And the world gets turned upside down. You say, well, I don't know if I could do that. I don't know if you're supposed to do exactly what Paul did, but God has you there for some purpose, right? He has you there for some reason. Is it that difficult to find Christians in that city? Usually not. Now, there may be some countries in the world where the Christians are all hidden, but in most places, if you ask around a little bit, you will find out where Christians are. I remember reading one time about Brother Andrew going into a communist country, and he thought, how can I find the other Christians? I don't know where they are. And of course, it was dangerous to start asking around. But he finally decided he would do what he could, and he stood up on a public bus. And he said real loud in every language he can think of something about, you know, I want to go to church. Where are the Christians? And everybody looked sort of shocked, and they didn't know what to say. And then later, as one of the ladies was leaving the bus, she slipped him a piece of paper. And that started the first contact, and it started things going. Do you understand this? You can find where those Christians are. And more importantly, once you know where they are, God will also bring to you people who you're working with in that town, or he'll bring you people that you'll bump into as you're traveling. And you can say to them, you know, I'd like to share with you a little bit about Christ, and I'd like you to meet some people who can help you with this. And the people that you will introduce them to are the Christians that you met there in that town, and then you're gone again. But did God use you to do something to turn someone's life upside down? The answer would be, yes, he did. It's not God's way for you to sit on your hands while you're waiting for something to happen. Instead, he says, I put you here in this place for this many days. There's a purpose in this. There's a reason for it. And that's Paul's attitude. So Paul gets there, and let's take a look at what he does. While Paul was waiting for them in Athens, he was greatly distressed that the city was full of idols. I read somewhere where there were thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands of idols that we know about now that were there, because they keep finding them. Every time you walk through Athens, you bump into another idol or the remains of one, and that doesn't even count the ones that were inside of people's houses. There were idols and statues and things to worship everywhere. So what did he do? Verse 17, he reasoned in the synagogues with the Jews and with the God-fearing Greeks, as well as in the marketplace day by day with those who happened to be there. Let me make sure you caught all this. He would go to the synagogue every Sabbath, and he'd say, you Jews, you live in this place that's filled with idols, and moreover, you haven't recognized the one that you should know, and that is Jesus as Savior. He told them that. But he didn't just leave it at that. Every single day, He would go to the agora, the marketplace, and he would go there and he would find people who were sitting around talking about things. This would be the equivalent of going to U of M and going to the Diag, where everybody's either playing frisbee or sitting around and thinking philosophical thoughts or whatever. And he would go and he'd reason with them, meaning he'd find a little group of them and he'd say, yes, but you should know about Christ, and you don't know the things you should know. And he would talk to them every day about these things. And he did this day after day after day. A group of Epicurean and Stoic philosophers began to dispute with him. In the marketplace, there were people who considered themselves philosophers. And I'm going to tell you something. These two groups of philosophers didn't even agree with each other, although they both sort of gang up and saying, we don't agree with this third guy either. Let's hear just a word about these two types of people. The Epicurean philosophers, in summary, they would say, the greatest good is personal happiness through pleasure and self-gratification. Anything that feels good, anything your heart desires, do it. That's the greatest good. You can have God, if there's a God, or however we were made, is made just so we could enjoy ourselves and have as much personal pleasure as possible. That was their philosophy. The Stoic philosophers had the opposite point of view, and they didn't get along with each other. The Stoic philosophers said the greatest good comes from the delay of gratification, which produces greater self-sufficiency and personal stability. That's the greatest good, is if you see you can kind of put off all of your pleasures so you can be more self-sufficient. I should ask you, do either one of these philosophies sound prevalent in our society today? I think we have a number of Epicureans in our society who don't know that word, but have adopted their philosophy. So both of these groups would talk with each other and reason with each other and maybe even have conflict with each other, but Paul showed up and began to teach something different, and they began to dispute with him. Some of them asked, what is this babbler trying to say? Still in verse 18. The word for babbler is a word that is literally one that means a seed picker. And it pictures a little bird that goes around and picks up a seed here and picks up a seed here and picks up a seed, scattered seeds. And it was not a compliment. That's why this translation says the word babbler, which is not a compliment in English. If you have a seed picker, it is something where a bird would pick up something here and pick up something here, and it would all be completely random, and it wouldn't add up to anything especially. And so they said, this guy is obviously one of those seed pickers who hasn't thought deeply the way we have. Instead, he's picked up a random idea here and a weird idea there, and none of this makes any sense. That's what they were accusing him of. Others remark he seems to be advocating foreign gods. You say, gods? I thought he was speaking of one god. Well, no, they thought there were gods, and they weren't listening very closely, I don't think, and I'll tell you why. They said this because Paul was preaching the good news about Jesus and the resurrection. Listen now, in their view, he seems to have been talking about two gods, a male god and a female god. There was this male god named Jesus, and there was this other god named resurrection. And they didn't know who either of them were, but they weren't listening all that close. And they said, he's talking about a couple of gods, maybe this married god and goddess, and I don't know what his deal is. And they said, we don't really understand what he's talking about. So they took him, either they invited him or they compelled him to go, I'm not sure which. They took him and brought him to a meeting of the Areopagus. Some of your translations will say Mars Hill, same thing. Ares was the name of one of their gods, a god of war. Mars was another name for the same guy. And so Ares, or Mars, had a hill named after him. And the hill was called Mars Hill, or Areopagus, and they would get together at this place and they would all think about philosophical things. At the Areopagus, they would think about these philosophical things, and over the years, they became something like the religious and cultural police. The ones who would think about what should we be thinking in this town? How will we be the bureau or the ministry of thought here in Athens? And they brought him to face these guys. I'm sure they were probably an imposing bunch of people. I don't know if we have anything just exactly like this in our country, but if you were called before Congress, or if you were called before a whole group of university professors or something like that and told you're going to have to now explain what you believe, that's what they've asked him to do. It's an interesting thing, and something that I think Paul sees as an opportunity rather than a bad thing. He's being brought in front of people, and he's going to be able to say, this is what I believe in, this is why. They took him and brought him to a meeting of the Areopagus, verse 19. They said to him, May we know what this new teaching is that you're presenting. You're bringing some strange ideas to our ears, and we want to know what they mean. And now, as a parenthetical comment, verse 21, all the Athenians and the foreigners who lived there spent their time doing nothing but talking about and listening to the latest ideas. Some cities were working towns, and this city was one where they all talked and talked and talked about philosophy all day long. And they thought, he's brought a strange and a sort of a weird new philosophy. Let's hear what he has to say. Paul then stood up in the meeting of the Areopagus and said, men of Athens, I see that you are in every way very religious. That word for religious is a word that, depending on the context, could either mean you're very religious and you positively worship things, or it could be sort of negative, which means I see that you're very superstitious and you've got a lot of religious practices that make no sense. And you have to kind of figure out, based on the context, what someone would mean. We do the same thing with the word religion down to this day, don't we? Sometimes we mean it as something quite positive, and occasionally we mean it as something that seems a little bit, not so good. And so he says, in this case, I see that you're very religious. I can tell that, and I'll tell you why I can see this. For, verse 23, I was walking around to look carefully at your object of worship. I saw all the different things. I found an altar with this inscription. I looked, he says, as I was looking at all your altars, and I found one that had some words on it. And that altar said, to an unknown God. Somebody had built an altar to worship the God that they didn't know about. And you might say, why would somebody do that? Well, these folks were so religiously concerned. Is everyone listening? They were so concerned that they thought, we've worshipped these dozens or hundreds of other gods, but we might have missed one. It's possible there's a God who might get upset with us because we didn't catch all of them. Let's build one more altar to the God that we don't know about, just in case. And so they even did that. And Paul says, I noticed you're very religious. You're interested in religious things. You built an altar to the unknown God. Now, I'm going to tell you, what you worship is something unknown. I am going to proclaim to you. I would like to tell you about the God that you don't know. It was an interesting beginning. I'm sure it caught all of their attention. That is an interesting way for him to go. So, the key here to all of this is that the people brought him to this place and asked him, what do you believe? We want to hear about it. And Paul answered. He didn't say, I'm not prepared to say anything about that right now. Let me get some notes together and I'll tell you later. He didn't say, I'm too shy to be able to say this in front of all of you. Maybe when the rest of the missions team arrives, we can get a presentation up. They asked, and in a strange city, outnumbered by people who probably are going to reject what he has to say, he answered. As it turns out, God has prepared the hearts of a few people there who will receive it, and a lot of people who are going to reject it. Isn't that the way it often is? And so what God would say to us is, speak it out. Tell other people about it, and a great number of people won't believe it. A great number of people won't receive it. But there are some that God has prepared who will. Find them. Tell them about this. Do it. That's what Paul is doing here. He's doing it at a risk of his own rejection, at a risk of his own unpopularity. Honestly, at some of these cities, at a risk of rioting and a risk of threats to his life and so forth, in order to reach those who have hearts prepared by God to receive salvation through Christ. Paul's example demonstrates a biblical principle. We're going to make this an Acts fact, and it's really a verse from Scripture. You see, he was brought before a group of people, and they asked him, what is it that you believe? Tell us what you believe. And the Bible tells us the following. This comes from 1 Peter chapter 3. But in your hearts, set apart Christ as Lord. In other words, make Jesus the king of your life. Be sure that he's in charge. Always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give the reason for the hope that you have, but do this with gentleness and respect. Here the Bible tells us, make sure you're ready always. There are going to be people who will ask you, what is it you believe? Why do you believe this? Be ready. Make sure you're serving Christ as your Lord, and then be ready to answer that. This is something the Bible asks us to do, and it's something that Paul is putting into practice here. I think it's exciting. He said, I'm here in this strange city. I've got I don't know how many days or weeks or months. I'm going to be putting every bit of this into action. And then they asked him, and then he gives them an answer. What does he say to them? This comes to the last part of our message, the message at Mars Hill, starting here at verse 24. He says to them, as he speaks to them, the God who made the world and everything in it is the Lord of heaven and earth and does not live in temples built by human hands. Paul starts his message by focusing on God as the creator. He says, God made the world, and he made everything in it. He's the Lord of heaven and earth, and he doesn't dwell in temples built by hands. Certainly, he's not served by hands that make idols. You've got to understand what he's saying here. He says, let me see. I've looked all around, and you all have made a ton of idols. You've shaped all these idols with your own hands. Doesn't that seem a little crazy to you when God himself made the world? How are you going to be making little things that help God out when he made the whole deal? Doing this out of human hands isn't the way we want to go. He's not served by hands that make idols. God made vast planets. He doesn't need us to help him in this way. He's already done it all for us. God gives life and breath to all men. He gives everything else we need. He started with one man. Let's read verse 25 and following. He's not served by human hands as if he needs anything, because he himself gives all men life and breath and everything. From one man, he made every nation of men that they should inhabit the whole earth, and he determines the set times for them and the exact places where they should live. From that first man that God made came every nation of men. God caused these nations to inhabit the whole earth, and he set the time and place where each one should live. This is true for all peoples, and it's true for you all the way down to today. I need you to hear this. I don't want anyone here to lament that you were maybe born in the wrong time or the wrong place or in the wrong circumstances. God himself puts every single one of us in the generation where we live, and in the place where we live, and he does it for a specific purpose. He does it for a good reason. Someone here may say, oh, you don't know, I grew up in a really rough family and so on, and God says, I put you in that family so that you would reach out for me and that you would find Jesus as Savior. Someone says, well, God put me in a really kind of an average, normal situation. God put you there so that you would reach out to God and find Jesus as Savior. Someone says, well, God put me in a wonderful Christian family where there was a lot of really exciting things happening spiritually. God put you there so that you would reach out for God and find Jesus as Savior. Someone says, well, God put me in a far-off nation, and then I came here to America in the last few years. God put you there and then brought you here so that you'd reach out for God and find Jesus as Savior. Everywhere that God puts people, he puts them in places so that they will understand that their need is to reach out and find the Lord. That's what Paul says here. God did this, verse 27, so that men would seek him and perhaps reach out for him and find him, though he is not far away from each of us. Notice those words again. I even put them on the screen. He did this. He put you where you are. He put you in this building today so that you would reach out and find God, and he is not that far away. Does everyone understand this? This is not coincidental, accidental. Somebody may think, I came here because I just needed a ride somewhere, and this was the stop that somebody was willing to do on the way here. Whatever it is, you are here because God put you here so that you might reach out and find God. That's why he has done this. And everyone here who already knows Christ will be able to say, there was a moment in my life when all of the things came together in such a way where I was living on a certain hallway in a dormitory, and the next door neighbor was a Christian who came and shared the Lord with me. Why were you living next door to that one? God put you there. You get this? God is the one who puts each one in the place where they are so that they will find him. And the Apostle Paul says, God has put all of you right here in Athens, in a place where you've become very religious, and you're reaching out to know God. I can see that. And now he's put me here, and now we've met each other. And you can reach out and find Christ as Savior and be saved now. God has put these circumstances together in this wonderful way, says Paul. God did this so that men would seek him and perhaps reach out for him and find him, though he's not far from each of us. For in him we live and move and have our being. As some of your own poets have said, we are his offspring. This is very interesting to me. What happens is, and you need to hear this, there are several ways that God reveals himself to people. I'll show you a little list of them here. God reveals himself through creation. God says, I'm here, I'm here. Look around, see everything that I made. Look at the earth, look at the people, look at all this. I am here. And he reveals himself through creation. Psalm 19 says, the heavens declare the glory of God, the heavens being the skies, all the stars and all that. It says, if you look at creation, you'll see who God is. God reveals himself through Scripture. The Bible says this is him breathing out or speaking out his very thoughts to us. God reveals himself finally through Jesus. He has spoken to us through his Son. In Hebrews chapter 1, it says, in former times he spoke through the Scriptures in all these ways, but in these last days he spoke to us by his Son. Why am I telling you all this? This is very interesting. When the Apostle Paul would go to the synagogue and talk to the Jews, he would say, you already know about the Scriptures. Let's make that the basis for our discussion. You know about the Bible. This is what it says. It points to Jesus. He gets here to these people in Athens, and they don't know anything about the Bible. Not one thing. So, does Paul have anything to base his comments on? Of course he does. He says, God has already revealed himself to you in at least one way, by creation. Look at what he has done. He has made people. He has made the earth. He's done all of this, and he uses creation as his example of how God has revealed himself. And then he says, but he's revealed himself even more through Jesus Christ, his Son. Therefore, verse 29, since we are God's offspring, we should not think that the divine being, that is God, is like gold or silver or stone, an image made by God, man's design and skill. I think that's an interesting verse, and I'll tell you why. He says, since God made people, and we are in some ways in his image, so we reflect this and we're living, how can you think that something that you have made, which is not living, can represent God? It can't do that. In the past, God overlooked such ignorance. You didn't know. But now he commands all people everywhere to repent. For he has set a day when he will judge the world with justice by the man, that is Jesus, he has appointed. He has given proof of all of this to all men by raising him from the dead. Now Paul gets into it about Jesus. He says, God created all of this. God is going to bring a judgment to people, and he's going to do that through Jesus. And we know that Jesus is the one that we need to trust in, because Jesus not only lived, but he died and rose again. When they heard about the resurrection of the dead, verse 32, some of them sneered. Some of them said, resurrection of the dead? That's the dumbest thing I have ever heard of. And they were scornful. But others said, we want to hear you more again on this subject. At that point, Paul left the council. A few men became followers of Paul and believed. Some of them were saved. Among them was Dionysus, a member of the Areopagus, one of those bigwigs who was a part of this council, said, I believe it, and got saved. Also a woman named Damaris and a number of others. All of what Paul is doing can be characterized by one word, and that is the word apologetics. Some of you know that word. It's a word that says, let's have an answer, a reasonable explanation of what we believe, and it may be a different starting point depending on who we're talking to. These people, all they knew was the creation around them and then a lot of idols. So he started at a starting point that they could mutually understand, and he built an explanation of who Jesus Christ is. That brings us to our next fact. In talking with people about God, a simple starting point is creation. That's what Paul did in this case. This was simple apologetics. He said, let's agree on something. There's a creation around us, right? And then he built from there. A simple starting point is creation. If there is art, there must be an artist. If there is creation, there must be a creator. A year or two ago, I went to the Ann Arbor Art Fair. That's coming up next weekend, and in fact, Dan Griffith from our church is getting together a little group of folks who are going to go to the art fair and share with people about Christ. I remember a discussion I had with some folks at the art fair. I was there doing something similar. We had several people from our church, and I went into a tent, and there was artwork from some high schoolers from Detroit. And a high school art teacher had brought a lot of their artwork in, and they had put it all around the tent. And the students themselves were there. And I began talking with the students and with the art teacher. And I don't know what the art teacher's convictions were. She seemed to at least be sympathetic to some things about God. The students themselves looked like they'd never heard anything about the Lord. And I felt the Lord drawing me to say to them, tell me, who is it who made this picture? And one of the girls said, I did. And I said, you've got that picture. Now, you drew that, didn't you? Oh, yes, she said. I said, since there is this piece of art that you drew, there must be an artist somewhere, and that's you. She said, oh, yeah. I said, well, take a look around at all of the things that have been made, people and animals and the world around us. That's the creation that is around us. She said, uh-huh. I said, you would know that behind that creation there must be a creator, wouldn't there be? She said, oh, she said. And then some of the girls who were around her began just firing questions real fast. Yeah, but what about this? And they began asking about churches and Bibles and questions and Jesus, and it just became fast. And I made sure that the art teacher was there because I thought, I'm going to have somebody unhappy that I'm talking to minors here about this. And I said, well, where's your teacher? And the teacher stepped in, and I said, they're asking these questions. She said, oh, go right ahead, she said. And so they were just filled with a million questions. All it took was the one thing saying, since we have this creation around us, there must be this creator. And they had a million questions after that. This is a very simple way to begin to talk to people about who God is. A number of people believed, as we see in verse 33. There were some men, there were some key women. A new church was started in Athens as a result. And I think that it's exciting that all that, because Paul didn't sit around while he waited for the missionary team to come. He acted. He got busy doing something, and it was worth it. And so we've seen in this chapter, Paul traveling to three different cities. Soon, his missionary team will catch up with him. And when we get to chapter 18, he will leave Athens and go on to another city and other places in Greece. And we'll pick up this in a little bit. But we're going to transition into something else now.